A video about jiu-jitsu wielding suffragettes. Well, I guess reality really is stranger than fiction. But how and why did the women of the suffrage movement learn jiu-jitsu? Well, before I can answer those questions, I need to get into some background regarding the history of Japan and the English suffrage movement. Two topics which probably don't sound like they should go together. After over 200 years of isolation, Japan opened up its borders to trade in 1853, flooding European markets with Japanese goods and ushering in a period of fascination with the country's culture and traditions. This interest in Japanese culture eventually led to the establishment of England's first dojo in 1898. The Baritsu School of Arms and Physical Culture, aka the Baritsu Club, established by Edward William Barton Wright, offered a number of different self-defense classes, from fencing to boxing. Though the school's signature fighting style, Baritsu, was a combination of European boxing and Japanese jiu-jitsu. Barton was fascinated by the fact that jiu-jitsu, unlike Western boxing or wrestling, didn't require an overabundance of physical strength, relying more on speed, balance, and leverage. Jiu-jitsu's emphasis on skill over brute strength meant that Barton could also offer classes to female students, a controversial move at a time when many doctors worried that sports and physical activity posed untold risks to the female body. One of Barton's first female students, Edith Garud, along with her husband William, became lifelong advocates of jiu-jitsu, hailing the sport's emphasis on strategy and strength of mind over body. Edith and her husband were so taken with the sport that they eventually made the switch from students to teachers, when in 1908, they took over the administration of the Golden Square Dojo, after its original owner, Sadakazu Uyanishi, returned to Japan. Edith's reputation as a jiu-jitsu instructor soon caught the attention of the Women's Social and Political Union, who were interested in learning a way to defend themselves during political demonstrations, which had a tendency to turn violent. At the time, it was not common for detractors of the suffrage movement to abuse protesters physically as well as verbally, a problem which the police did little to remedy, as the powers that be took issue with the WSPU and their disruptive protests. Though Edith was not part of the suffrage movement, she sympathized with its members and believed that jiu-jitsu could help them level the playing field. So, in 1909, Garud started offering special suffragette classes that were only open to members of the WSPU and the Women's Freedom League. Garud was also responsible for training the members of the Bodyguard, an elite group of women tasked with guarding WSPU leader Emmeline Pankhurst. Dubbed the Amazons by the press, this group of around 30 women were trained in secret and expected to jump into action at a moment's notice, kinda like a suffragette secret service. In addition to their jiu-jitsu training, the members of the Bodyguard were taught to wield clubs, which they kept hidden under their dresses, and often employed disguises to fool the authorities. In 1914, while giving a speech at Camden Square, Pankhurst was cornered by police, who, after a fierce battle with the Bodyguard, succeeded in taking her captive. Or so they thought. Once the figure's veil was removed, the officers discovered that she was actually a decoy, and that the real Pankhurst had already disappeared. The suffragettes continued their fight for the vote until the outbreak of World War I, when their focus shifted towards helping the war effort, a course of action which probably contributed to Parliament's decision to pass the Representation of the People's Act, which granted voting rights to women over 30, if they owned property or were married to someone who did. While voting rights in England were not extended to all women 21 and older until 1928, after World War I, battles between the suffragettes and the police were much less common, and Garud and the Bodyguard gradually faded into obscurity, until recently, While Edith Garvudge may not be a household name, the connection between jiu-jitsu and the suffrage movement has been cited in movies, TV shows, and even a graphic novel series. Because who wouldn't want to watch a group of ladies in petticoats engage their opponents in mortal combat? Don't look at me like that. I know that's the real reason you clicked on this video. Well, I'm Silver Jade, and as always, I have to ask you to please remember to support your local library, and I hope to see you next time.